Dear colleagues, it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the third webinar of the initiative Dentists United by WH. I hope all of you are safe and you and your family is healthy. And I hope, although we have now some restrictions in terms of traveling and social life, that you can still enjoy a nice summer. If this is the first webinar you see now from the initiative Dentists United, let me shortly introduce you to the first two webinars. The first webinar has been on a topic which has buffered us a lot in 2020. And I'm now not talking about sweatpants or toilet paper. I'm talking about the masks. And the interest about masks is literally going up and down, back and forth since beginning of the year. So the first topic of the first webinar was repossessing single-use face masks, Yes, But, by Christian Stempf. And the second webinar has been quite recently by Professor Gassmann about aerosol in prophylaxis. Is it a danger for the dental team? If you got interested now in those two topics, you can easily watch a recording after this webinar on YouTube. But now about what we want to talk today. We want to talk about how we can get to business and whether and to which extent we can also get back to surgery. Let me shortly introduce you myself before I start with the webinar. I have studied dentistry in the university in Vienna in Austria, and after that I've been working at the Department for Periodontology and Oral Surgery, but have primarily focused on periodontology. Since 2014, I'm working at the Department of Periodontology at the University in Malmö in Sweden. And what do I love about working at the university? I love to do research, I love to treat patients, and also to educate the upcoming young colleagues. Having introduced myself to you, I think it would be super nice if all of you could leave a short message, like I have done in the chat, in the YouTube chat, like, "Hi, I'm Kristina, greetings from Sweden," so we can see a little bit from where all over the world people are watching us. But now finally to the webinar. About a month ago, WH asked me whether I could give a webinar on COVID-19 and oral surgery. And I have to be honest, in the beginning I was a bit skeptic, because I say honestly, I'm not a specialist in biology, I'm not a specialist in microbiology or hospital hygiene. So I said to them, okay, let me think 2 days and see a little bit what kind of ideas I get. And after those 2 days, we had a couple of discussions about which topics we could include in this webinar. And then actually we got, at least in our opinion, quite a nice idea what we could talk in this webinar. And so we hope that you're going to like it. So COVID-19 has buffered us a lot, or has been the main topic in 2020. But not only in our real life, also in research, this topic has developed tremendously since beginning of the year. Let me give you an example. If I put about a month ago the two terms dentistry and COVID-19 in PubMed, I got already more than 340 hits on this topic, just from beginning the year. Then, not even 2 weeks later, there have been another 100 additional publications, just within 2 weeks. And today in the morning, we reached already almost 500 publications. So within a month, plus 160 publications on this topic. So it is really developing very, very fast. But now to the topics we have chosen for this webinar. We want to discuss with you what is the risk of meeting a COVID-19 positive patient in our office. What about the personal protective equipment? What should we consider, where we can get nice information from? How can we minimize the risk during surgery for us, for our team, for the patients? Why we definitely should not skip the cooling during the surgery? And how long can we actually wait if we have done parts of the surgery procedures, like a sinus lift and augmentation procedure, before the pandemic? How long can we wait now before we plan to place the implant in our patients? Let's start with the risk of meeting a COVID-19 positive patient. I've made some calculations for you to illustrate to the risk of meeting a COVID-19 positive patient. And I've taken as an example Austria, for the one side because I come from Austria, but for the other side also because WH, the headquarters of WH, are in Austria. They are somewhere here called Bürmoos. So Austria has a population of almost 9 million inhabitants. And a month ago, when I was appointed to this webinar, we had about 440 active cases, which corresponds to 0.005% of the population. If we say now that we meet about 30 patients per day in our office, that sums up to a risk per working day to meet out of those 440 active cases of 0. And then there come 5 × 0.02%. To give you now a relation how big this risk actually is, let me compare to you how big are the chances that we guess the 6 correct numbers out of 45 in the lottery. And that those chances are actually 3 times higher than meeting one of those 440 cases. Or another example, how big is the risk to be struck by lightning in a lifetime? That is much bigger than meeting a patient on one single working day. Of course, then one has to put in relation that we are talking about a lifetime versus a single working day. And I definitely do not want to put now the risk down that there would be hardly any chance to meet an active case, because it depends a lot on where we are working and how the situation in the specific country is. Because, for example, this was mid of June. And if you take the data from today from Austria, the numbers are, in general in Europe, unfortunately increasing again. So we have at the moment more than 1,000 active cases again. And if you make now the same calculations, you can see that the risk per working day is already increased by 2.5 again. And then definitely we also have to keep in mind those 1,240 cases are the active cases, those cases which are actually registered. Then there is this huge amount of cases which are not registered, which are unknown, maybe they have no symptoms. And there we can only approximately guess how big this number is. We know, for example, Germany has come up with a publication saying that they guess the number is approximately twice as big as the actually registered cases. But for example, Italy says it is about 6 times as big. So it depends a lot on the country where we are working in. So if we look now, for example, into Europe, this is from a Danish publication, and they have reported on the new infections within 1 week in June per 100,000 inhabitants. And you can see that in most parts of Europe, except for Great Britain, Portugal and Sweden, the new infections have been actually relatively low and below 10 new infections per 100,000 inhabitants. And also Great Britain and Portugal has been at least below 20 new infections per 100,000 inhabitants. But now we look at this big red line in the very top in Sweden, where I'm working. Here the numbers of new infections have been more than 7 to 8 times bigger than in all the other European countries, just in one single week. So it depends really a lot on where you're working and how well the situation is under control, how big your risk is of meeting a COVID-19 positive patient. And then, of course, we know the current hotspots of the pandemic is actually not Europe, but is North and South America. And they are contributing tremendously to the total number of cases with more than 12 million and to the total number of deaths to COVID-19 with more than 500,000. Of course, one could say now, US is contributing so much because it also has a bigger population. But if you look a little bit in detail here on this homepage of the WHO, which I can only recommend, it's very nice and gives you nice details. And if we standardize the numbers now per 1 million population, then we can see that the numbers in North and South America are twice as high, so confirmed cases, compared to Europe. After I've given you now those numbers about the risk and how big the risk is now to meet a COVID-19 positive patient in your office, I think we are all aware that we definitely shouldn't take it easy, and we all know that. And I would like to show you one part of a very nice lecture which Professor Hemmerle has given sometime in May for Geistlich. And if I can only recommend to watch it, you have here the YouTube link. And I have stolen one of his slides, because I think it is a very impressive slide how much this virus has affected our population. So you can see here the different countries, and the blue line indicates the rate of death in the previous years. And the red line is 2020. And you can see in how many countries it made a tremendous peak now around March, April, May. So we can really see the effect of this pandemic on our population. So even if in some countries the risk to meet the COVID-19 positive patient in our office might be small, we really have to be careful. Why is it buffering us now so much in dentistry? We all know why. Because of this. Because we are working in almost all of our procedures with aerosol producing procedures. So we constantly have a spray of aerosols and droplets, and we have that in a very close relationship to the patient. So we're working in a very short distance next to our patient. And unfortunately, as we know from a nice and early publication, the New England Journal of Medicine, the SARS-CoV-2 virus is surviving a couple of hours in the aerosols and even longer on surfaces. So it is not dying immediately after it leaves the mouth of the patient or after it has fallen down from the aerosols somewhere in our office. Those are the reasons why we think so much about it. But how much has it infected now dentistry? And let me show you here a publication from Italy. We all know that Italy has been a country which has been quite severely affected. And they have made a questionnaire by which they try to assess the symptoms and signs, the protective measures, the awareness, the perception levels of dentists during the COVID-19 pandemic. And they have sent out this questionnaire to more than 9,000 dentists and got the response from 3,600 dentists. Almost 50% of these dentists actually continued to work after February 21st, when there was the real outbreak in Italy. About 14% of them described that they suffered one or more symptoms which could be referable to COVID-19. But then, of course, we have to say, okay, fatigue is now not the most specific symptom, because then maybe we would always have the symptom Monday morning or Friday evening. But still. And this is now the interesting part. Only 1% of those 3,600 responses was actually tested positive for SARS-CoV-2. And only half of them developed the disease. And we have heard similar low numbers from publications from China, so that is actually good news for us. Nevertheless, we have to keep in mind who is actually responding on such a survey. Maybe not those who are sick or lying in the hospital, but still it gives us some impression how much dentists might be affected by it. So which measurements have those dentists not taken while they continued to work? In more than 80% of the cases, they were washing their hands before and after each procedure, what we should anyway do. They frequently ventilated the waiting room. They tried to change the schedule to avoid a full waiting room. They verified the patient's current health status after the patient arrived at the office, so they asked again whether there are any symptoms or not, and I will come back more in detail a little bit later. When booking the patients, they applied the phone triage, and I will also come back a little bit later to that, what we can ask here. And what is probably very important, they disinfected the push buttons, all the surfaces, the chairs, several times a day. On the contrary, what have they not done so often? So in less than 25% of the cases. And that was actually measuring either the patient's or the team's body temperature. And which rinsing solutions were used most often? That was chlorhexidine and water peroxide. we all know in the meanwhile the discussions that chlorhexidine is most likely not as effective as we would like it to be, so that normally it is recommended to use water peroxide and povidine iodine. But for details on that, I would like to refer you to the seminar or webinar from Professor Gassmann, because he has addressed the topic of the rinsing solutions in detail. Which personal protective equipment has been used by these dentists? Of course, they have gloves and face shields, a surgical mask and a headset. What was a little bit surprising for me, that actually the rate of using FFP2 masks was relatively low, so only every second dentist was actually using an FFP2 mask. And quite seldomly, they have been using a gown. And with that, I'm already halfway into the next topic, the personal protective equipment before and after COVID-19. For this, I would like to refer you to recommendations which have been published by the European Federation of Periodontology, the EFP. So you find very nice infographics on the homepage of the EFP. I will shortly also show them to you now. But please keep in mind that those are recommendations and not guidelines, because for guidelines we would need to have some scientific evidence, which we unfortunately do not have yet as much as we would like them to have them already. So how do those recommendations look like now? When we book our patients, we should always think about the phone triage. And this phone triage can include a couple of questions. Of course, we should ask the patients whether they know whether they have COVID-19, but more important, whether they have any symptoms which could be related to COVID-19, so like fever, coughing, or respiratory difficulty, whether they have been maybe in contact with someone else who was tested later on positive for COVID-19, or whether they have been in a high-risk region recently. Another very important point is that we should assess the patient risk profile and needs. That means we should clearly assess, okay, what does this patient need? Is it really necessary to do it now? And how high is the risk of the patient to develop maybe a more severe form of the disease? And I will come back a little bit more in detail on that later, which are the high-risk patients. And third, we should organize our schedule as much as possible in a way that the waiting room is not too full. What do we do when the patient is arriving? We can register the temperature and send those patients with increased temperature back home. They should remove the bags, mobiles, and coats. We should provide them with hydroalcoholic solution to disinfect the hands. We should repeat the triage again in the office. If all that is okay, we let the patients wait in the waiting room with a good distance from each other. And in best case, we should have open windows in the waiting room. We can let them put on shoe covers. And what is actually missing here, in my opinion, is, of course, we let them rinse before we start with the procedure to reduce the virus load in the oral cavity. What should be done by us and by our team? Of course, we should disinfect our hands. We can put on the first pair of gloves. We put on a gown. We can put on a cap. We should use the FFP masks. Then, of course, goggles or face shields would be recommended, and potentially a second pair of gloves. How and what can we do now during patient treatment? Of course, if possible, we should avoid the aerosol production. But we all know that that is, in many cases, simply not possible, because otherwise we cannot treat our patients. So if we decide, okay, we have to do a procedure which produces aerosols, we should definitely use, we should definitely use a high power suction to reduce the aerosol load in the air in the operating room as much as possible. Another option could be those patient shields, so that the aerosols stay within the shield and are not buffering us so much. Potentially, we can use decontaminating sprays, and between the patients, if possible, we should ventilate the room and, of course, disinfect all surfaces Now, one important step, because I think that might be sometimes, you know, when we are done with the patients, we want to get rid of all the stuff. Maybe next patient is already waiting, we have to dress up again. Then we shouldn't be too fast, and we should be thinking how we remove all this personal protective equipment. So we start with the first pair of gloves and the gown, then with the face shield. And with the face shield, always try to touch it from behind and not at the shield where you have all or most of the aerosol sticking on. Then we remove the mask and the hat, the second pair of gloves, and then of course, after throwing all that, we disinfect our hands. Here I can recommend you definitely the homepage of the Center for Disease Control and Prevention. There are quite some nice infographics and also videos about all that. So if you think about now the personal protective equipment, it has changed a lot compared to how we have done previously regular checkups or maybe a filling. It has changed maybe a little bit less compared to surgery, because there we always have been a little bit more dressed up, but we might need to add the FFP2 masks, face shield, and bigger goggles. Whether it is necessary to dress up like that, as we see it now very frequently on various social media, to be honest, we don't know. We don't have any science on that, whether it is really necessary and whether it really significantly reduces our risk to get infected. So there we have to wait until we get stronger data. Until then, I can only refer you to the recommendations which I have shown you already from the EFP, or as you see it, for example, here from WH, which you find on the homepage of Dentists United, where you can see listed, depending on the different procedures, what kind of personal protective equipment might be recommended on the knowledge or based on the knowledge we have today. But now, back to business, back to surgery. What do we have to consider there? If we think about surgery, of course we have many different surgical procedures. It might be a wisdom tooth which got infected, is bothering the patient really a lot, the patient cannot wait any longer. Or it might be more elective procedures like an implant installation or a sinus lift procedure. Or maybe we are talking about a procedure where we can work without any aerosol production at all, about mucogingival surgery. So it depends a lot about which type of surgery you would like to do. But how can we now minimize the risk during surgery for us, for our team, and for the patients? Maybe we have to think about which type of surgical technique we are choosing. So let me give you some examples. If you think about collecting bone to fill up a defect, as you can see it here, for example, to fill up per implant bone defect, then you see on the right side a very nice option with the piezomet and with the bone collector, which goes easy, which goes fast, but unfortunately is producing aerosols. So maybe at the moment, if the risk is higher, you should stay more to the two options shown on the left and in the center. We've taken a respiratorium or small forceps and collect in that way a tortuous bone. Or maybe we make it even more easy and go to the cupboard and use some bone substitutes. But of course it should fit to the corresponding indication, what we want to use it for. Or let me give you another example, periodontal surgery. We all love our ultrasonic scalers because it goes fast, it goes easy, it is nice, but unfortunately at the moment they are producing aerosols. So maybe we can stay, at least for the time being, more with the hand instrument. Although it is less handsome, it goes a little bit tougher, it takes longer time, but it has at the moment a big advantage that it is not producing any aerosols. Another important factor during surgery is to use a suction. So you can see here now on the left side, either an implant, so a surgical handpiece, or the piezomet. And you can see how, without any suction, the aerosols are all over the picture. On the right side, you see now the same setting, but with a suction in place. You can, of course, we cannot diminish completely the aerosol production. but we can reduce it. So we really have to tell our assistants, please try to focus, please really stay where I'm working and try to catch as much as possible. So the suction is a very relevant factor. But not only the suction, also the settings of the corresponding device. So use it with the right amount of water. And then it might be also about the timing. So you see, for example, now on the lower left side, if you start the device already outside of the mouth, you have it everywhere and it's spraying into the mouth and back out of the mouth. So try really, when you go first in the mouth, place the suction and then start the procedure. And those small things can simply reduce the aerosol production, the aerosol load in the operating rooms. A little bit more details on the suction. For the prophylaxis, we know that we have quite nice big suctions which can reduce a lot the aerosol production. Unfortunately, for the surgery, we are still somehow sticking a little bit with the small, tiny suctions. So I would recommend to use maybe additionally a suction, second suction, which you put just somewhere in the corner of the mouth, or maybe use bigger suctions also for surgery. Because you also have to consider the ones up here. If you take now, for example, the data from Bertl and Dahl, they have a capacity of 300 liters per minute. And those surgical suctions go down to 45 liters per minute. That, of course, if one gives it, illustrates that here with salt, one can see how different is just one stroke with the suction in the amount of salt taking up. Whether such extra or suctions are advantages, we don't know. It sounds logic because it helps us again to reduce the aerosols, but unfortunately we do not have any scientific data on it. Because if one looks into PubMed, one only finds one single publication on extraoral vacuum aspirators. And that publication is actually already from 2001. And if one looks at the device which they have been using, we can call it a little bit old-fashioned already. Nevertheless, they have reported that it significantly reduced the load of bacteria and the contamination in the operating room. So most likely they make sense, but which device is not the best, because of course there are now also many on the market, we cannot answer yet, at least not on the scientific base. If we think now about the suction and the virus load, and one could maybe also get the thought, okay, but if I use now a lot of water with my devices, so for example for the counter-angle handpiece or the piezo implant mat, up to 100 milliliters per minute, maybe I can actually dilute the virus load because the amount of saliva is actually maximum about 2 milliliters per minute. So if one would make a simple calculation, that would be actually a dilution of up to 200 times. But that is unfortunately not the case. Because first of all, if I spray now into the mouth, whatever comes out is not mixed like a cocktail and completely diluted with each other. So I spray in and I get parts of the saliva back out. So I cannot say whatever gets out is 200 times diluted. And we also do not know exactly how big is then the virus load in whatever gets mixed up. But there is one quite nice publication, also of course from this year, and they have measured in a couple of deceased patients the virus load in the saliva. So primarily look now at the blue circles. This is the data for the saliva. And you can see the highest load was in the first 7 days after the symptoms onset. Of course, now we can say if the patient has symptoms, he will definitely not come in our office because that we want to catch with the triage. But they also found still virus copies in the saliva up to 25 days after the symptoms onset. And on average, they calculated that there are almost 160,000 copies of the virus per milliliter saliva. So that is really a huge amount what we are facing here. Now, how can we minimize the risk for the patients? We should minimize the risk for the patients by means of a good patient selection. On the one side, we should definitely follow the guidelines from the World Health Organization, saying that older adults and people with underlying health conditions are at higher risk of developing severe forms of COVID-19. So those patients we should not get in if we can avoid it for the moment. Those underlying health conditions could be diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, or lung diseases. And that is the fact that is a problem for older and additionally diseased patients has been shown by another nice publication from Italy. They have looked more in detail on the diseased patients, and there you can see that the case fatality rate is relatively low up to 60 years. From 60 to 70, it starts to increase a little bit, and then above 70 starts to become really high. And then additionally, the diseases. Three out of four patients who died from COVID-19 had hypertension, every third had diabetes, and many of them had cardiovascular diseases. And then what is interesting and good to know for us, the more comorbidities they had, the higher was the risk for them to die from COVID-19. So those are things we should calculate and think of if we plan and book our schedule with our patients. And that is another factor, smoking. We know, or there was now a recent systematic review with a meta-analysis on the prevalence, severity and mortality of COVID-19 associated with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, so COPD, and smoking. And they collected the data of approximately 2,500 COVID-19 patients out of 15 studies. And here one could see a clear and significant tendency. So COPD patients and smokers had a clearly increased risk to develop more severe diseases. So for COPD patients, the risk was almost double. And for smokers, it was almost 50% higher compared to non-smokers to develop a more severe disease. So also with those patients, we really have to be more careful when we plan to call them in. Another important factor is, what are we doing with our instruments when we are done with our procedure? Here I can only recommend you stay with the guidelines from your company or from the producer of your instruments. But it is definitely advantageous if one can take apart the instruments in many small pieces so that the cleaning can be more efficient. And you also find some nice information on the homepage of Dentists United about this. Now the second last point. Why we can't skip the cooling during surgery? I think this is something what we all know, somewhere far back in our mind, but I would like to bring it now during these times back up, and that we really do not forget that. If we are not using proper irrigation and we are working on bone or drilling in bone, if we heaten up the bone up to 42 to 45 degrees, we produce a reversible heat shock in the bone tissue. If we keep the temperature for at least a minute around 47 degrees, we produce an irreversible heat shock. And that is something what we definitely do not want when we are placing our implants. And in case we actually manage to reach 70 degrees, we would induce immediate bone cell death. Of course, the heat production is not only dependent on the irrigation, it also depends on the bone quality, on the drilling speed, or on the pressure, but the irrigation is probably the most important variable and should always be used if you are working and drilling in bone. There shouldn't be any discussion on that. Now the last point, how long can we actually wait without our surgery? So if you think now about that we have done, for example, a lateral ridge augmentation, how long can we wait with opening up and placing the implant to still find enough bone width afterwards? But the same for the sinus lift. How long can we wait to still find enough bone height to place the implants? Let's start with the sinus lift. This is a very nice systematic review from a colleague who was also working shortly in Malmö at the university. And they have been looking through the literature, which has collected 3D graft volume data. So they were looking for publications who measured the 3D volume changes after sinus augmentation. And they could find 7 controlled and 5 uncontrolled studies. Altogether more than 230 sinus augmentations, and the follow-up ranged between 6 months and 6 years. And here something became quite obvious. So we see here the different graft material. This is autogelous bone, allograft, bone substitutes, and the composite. So for example, autogelous bone and the bone substitute. And we can see for the autogelous bone that the volume reduction was much higher than for the other materials. And additionally, it showed a bigger range than the other materials. So it might be more unpredictable which patients lose more bone over time and which patients lose less bone over time. But in general, if I'm using only autogelous bone from a sinus lift, I have to be aware that they lose more volume or earlier volume compared to, for example, if I use bone substitutes. Those are the results for the controlled studies, but it looked the same if one was combining the controlled and the uncontrolled studies. So what did the authors conclude on that? So the sinus augmentation is, or a sinus augmentation procedure with most of the biomaterials is in general followed by significant volume reduction. But that's also the reason why we always over-augment a little bit, so that we know. However, unfortunately, most of the studies had a shorter follow-up, so we are still lacking a little bit data for the long-term follow-up. But, and that I think we should keep in mind, because that tells us maybe which patients we should call in earlier for placing the implant, which maybe can wait a little bit longer, is if I use only autogenous bone, I have to be aware that I probably use considerably more volume than compared with bone substitutes. And it might vary more among my patients. So for autogenous bone, it was approximately 45%. And for the bone substitutes, the volume reduction was only about 20-23%. And the same tendency was also shown in a preclinical study. In this study, they wanted to see more exactly the volumetric changes after maxillary sinus floor augmentation with BIOS and or autogenous bones. So they made a study in mini pigs to be able to define exactly the healing time and the mixture which was used for the sinus lift. So they had 5 different groups, and starting with only autogenous bone, then reducing autogenous bone until the last group was only with BIOS. And here we can see now the same as we have seen from the systematic review before. So if we have here on the left side the autogenous bone only, and on the right side the BIOS only, we can see that the volume reduction was much bigger in the autogenous bone, while in the BIOS, the volume reduction was much smaller. So the less autogenous bone we used, the smaller was the volume reduction. How is this now for lateral ridge augmentation procedures? Again, a systematic review with a meta-analysis on the fate of the lateral ridge augmentation. So the authors tried to assess the stability of bone grafting material after lateral ridge augmentation, and they collected the data from 15 randomized controlled clinical trials. They primarily concentrated on bone block procedures and TBR procedures. So you can see here the approximately gain in bone width after the block or the TBR procedure, and then here the loss over the time. And that was a little bit higher for the TBR procedure. And what also became evident for the TBR procedure is that it was dependent on what type of material was used. So, and there they could see that only autogelous bone, only allografts, or only xenogenic grafts was inferior compared to a combination of autogelous bone and xenografts. But in this combination again, maybe, as we have seen it for the sinus lift, the composition might have an effect. And that is now the last study which I would like to show you. It's a randomized controlled clinical trial and evaluated the volumetric changes after TBR with two different compositions of bone substitutes and autogenous bone. Directly postoperative and then after 7.5 months follow-up. The graft composition was either 60-40, so 60% bone substitute, 40% autogenous bone, or 90-10. Here are the results. You can see here on the left side the mixture. So in the first line, the 90-10 mixture, and in the second line, the 60-40 mixture. Then you can see the gain after 7.5 months was a little bit higher for the 60-40 mixture. And also the reduction from postoperative until 7.5 months was smaller for that group which had a little bit more autogenous bone. So we can also see here that the way how we are augmenting and which material we are using to augment makes an effect on the outcome and makes an effect how long we can actually wait now to place our implants. So with that, I'm at the end of this webinar. And yeah, to give you a short summary, it's somehow a little bit difficult with this topic, but I think that the most important thing is that we try somehow to keep a balance between the risk for the patients, but on the other hand, the patient needs the risk for ourselves, for our team. Of course, again, on the other hand, economy, and then we could probably add up this list now relatively long. But we have to find, depending on where we are working, which patients we are treating, which type of procedure we want to do, and we have to find a balance between all that. So, with that, I would like to thank you for listening. And I can see it also for writing already so much in the chat. And I would also like to thank WH for organizing this webinar. If you have later on any questions, you are more than welcome to drop me an email, or of course now I will have a look at the chat whether there are already any questions or you can place them now. Until then, I'll show you shortly the two previous webinars as a short reminder. If you like, maybe not this webinar, you also want to watch the two previous ones. And here you have a list of all the links and references used for this publication. So let's see now how it looks like in the chat. So there are many greetings from US, from Europe, from Peru. Then also a comment from Theo Hans. Yes, it's true that the turbine and the prophylaxis are those procedures which produce most of the aerosols. If you take, for example, the surgical handpiece, we have most of the bigger droplets which are not flying also so far. So let me see whether there are any other questions. But I can see we had quite a nice mixture of visitors to our seminar. That is nice. So until maybe there come some more questions or comments. So I think what is the most important is that we really make or find for ourselves somehow a useful risk assessment. So we have to consider what type of procedure we want to do, and we have to consider which patient it is. So for example, is it really necessary to place now an implant in an 85-year-old patient with maybe COPD and maybe he's still smoking? So most likely that wouldn't be the patient we would place exactly now, the implant on 3-6, because that tick can also survive a little bit longer without. So, there's now a question. What produces less aerosol, the high-speed handpiece or the piezo for osseous surgery? It depends, of course, a little bit on. What exactly we are doing, and it is a little bit difficult to find really scientific evidence-based an answer to that question: what is producing them more? But what we could see, for example, with the surgical handpiece, what I also said already, if you use slower rotations, it is producing not such a fine aerosol load. It's producing bigger droplets, but that a little bit less than, for example, the ultrasonic, or maybe also than the piezo. But I think what is in that term the most important is somehow the suction and the teamwork between you and your assistant. As I said, go first into the mouth, place the suction, and then start the procedure. Then the next question, please discuss the aerosol generation comparison between handpiece high speed versus electric. That has been also partly, if I remember it now correctly, addressed by the webinar of Professor Gassmann. And one has also seen it here in those two beans, which we had in the video. They are in general producing, so especially turbine and the high speed are producing more, or it seems that they are producing more aerosols compared, for example, to the piezomet or to the surgical handpiece. If that answers your questions. Then the next question would be, what if we mix water and water peroxide in the dental chair bottle? That could be for sure an idea, and that is also something what is taken up in the recommendations from the EFP, that it might be an idea to use disinfecting solutions, for example, especially during the prophylaxis. How much it really reduces our risk, we can only guess, as unfortunately with so many things at the moment. But it is for sure a good idea if also the producer or the company where you have your instruments from is recommending it or allowing it to use additionally some disinfecting solutions. But I am placing implants in this moment, in this very moment not. So we have been, I mean, as you could see in this one of the first slides, Sweden had or still has quite high numbers and also quite high numbers of new infections. So the university decided sometime in April to only do really the necessary procedures. And implant placement is considered as an elective procedure. And we are planning, because now in Sweden in July everyone is always on holiday, but when we come back in August, it is planned that we start with the surgical procedures as well, if the situation allows it. But for the moment, now April, May, June, we have not done any elective surgical procedures at the university. I know that, of course, colleagues in the private practice were doing it, but then I think it depends again whether I have, for example, a 22-year-old patient who is lacking one lateral incisor due to agenesis, or whether, as I had said before, I have an 85-year-old patient. The copy of the study of the external suction in 2001 is no problem. Easy as this if you drop me an email, and then I can send you a PDF of that one. So let me see whether I missed something. So then there was again a question whether we should use additional disinfecting solutions in the devices. As I said before, it is definitely an option. We do not really have data how much it is reducing it. What I definitely would keep or would tell the patients is to rinse before the procedure, because that is clearly reducing the virus load and also, of course, the bacterial load in the oral cavity. All the other procedures are things what we think about, which somehow make sense, but unfortunately we do not really have any data so that I could say, okay, either the water peroxide or any other substance works best to work as an additional solution in the irrigation. Then there was the question for the email address. Let's go back here. That was, I think, on the second last slide. After the thank you. So, here's the email address. So, if you just drop me an email, then it's no problem to send you one of the PDFs of the papers which I have used in this presentation now. Then there's a next question that dentists try to minimize the water cooling spray. But how can we know now whether that amount is sufficient for proper cooling and not cause any damage? In general, as I also said during the presentation, I would stay with the recommended minimum amounts of irrigation. So I wouldn't go down completely, because then you're simply really running risk of producing damage to the bone. And also, as I addressed it very shortly, it is unfortunately a little bit difficult to say whether now a higher irrigation or a lower irrigation really changes something in our risk, because the problem is primarily we spray something in the mouth and something combined with whatever we spray in gets out of the mouth again. And that can be a big load of virus or can be a smaller load of virus, but might actually not depend so much on how much irrigation we use. Again, it is, as you can maybe see, it is a little bit difficult for me to answer, because unfortunately we are really still lacking studies on this topic so that I could really say, okay, use more irrigation or use less irrigation. So that is not so easy to answer, unfortunately. Then there was a question whether it would be possible to get a recording. That is no problem. On the one side, if you want, you can listen next Tuesday at 10 a.m. again. On the other side, there will be a recording as for the two other webinars on YouTube, so you can just watch it again. That is no problem at all. Okay. Yeah, maybe as I said already, so we will repeat this webinar. So if you have maybe friends who have missed it, who had been at work, we will repeat this webinar next Tuesday at 10 a.m. So then you're welcome to tell your friends and to join again or put some more questions there. Okay. I hope I have not missed any of the questions. Otherwise, I think looks like we would be done. So if you come up later with some questions, as I said, no problem. Just drop me an email or pass by next Tuesday again. And yeah, with that, I would like to thank you. Now there was one more question before I close. When can you continue on a patient who went through COVID-19? I have shown you the one study about the virus load in those COVID-19 patients, and they did not have a huge number. It was about 30 or 40 patients, if I remember it now correctly. But the longest time period where they still could find a virus load in the saliva of the patient was 25 days. So that, I would say, is the least number of days. I would definitely add one more month, but that is now just a personal opinion. But up to a month, apparently, it might be possible that the virus is still present in the saliva. So that time period, I would definitely wait, and then I would probably add some safety range. Okay. Then with that, I would like to thank you for your nice participation in the chat, for the many questions, and yeah, see you maybe next Tuesday. Bye-bye.